Welcome to this introductory podcast in the series on brain development, mental health, and addiction. This podcast series is based on lectures from the Alberta Family Wellness Initiative, a knowledge mobilization initiative designed to translate scientific research into policy and practice. The podcasts were developed by the Association of Faculties of Medicine of Canada with guidance from a project advisory committee and produced by Hugh Kellum and Colin McDonald at the University of Ottawa. This project was sponsored by the Norlene Foundation. The entire series can be accessed via afmc.ca. The series is comprised of 13 podcasts, including this introduction. Six podcasts focus on core concepts of early childhood development, with the overall objectives of understanding how childhood experiences shape brain development, how this can either provide a strong foundation for lifelong health and well-being, or confer vulnerability to disease, as well as interventions and treatments that can help ensure children have the best possible start in life. The second six podcasts focus on the neurodevelopmental origins of addiction, with the overall objectives of defining addiction as a brain disorder and describing some of the most effective strategies to help prevent, intervene, and treat addictive disease. The goal of this series is to give you both the background knowledge on brain development and addiction and the reflective skills to apply this knowledge to your practice. Throughout this presentation, we will be hearing from some of the leading experts on brain development and addiction medicine from across Canada and the United States, as well as case studies and personal testimonials from professionals struggling with addiction. The podcast will also include a series of reflective questions that will link the specific learning objectives with the Medical Council of Canada objectives for the qualifying examination related to addiction. The MCC objectives are organized around physicians' roles as defined by the CanMeds and CanMeds FMU competency frameworks for undergraduate medical education. Today's topic will be an introduction to the development of addiction. We will talk about the definition and primary types of addiction, how early adversity in life can lead to the development of addiction, and how the reward system of the brain is sensitive during the early years of development and maturation. To begin, what is addiction? Well, the American Society of Addiction Medicine in 2001 defined addiction as a primary chronic disease of brain reward, motivation, memory, and related circuitry. Dysfunction in these circuits leads to characteristic biological, psychological, social, and spiritual manifestations. This is reflected in an individual pathologically pursuing reward and/or relief by substance use and other behaviors. Addiction is characterized by inability to consistently abstain, impairment in behavioral control, craving, diminished recognition of significant problems with one's behaviors and interpersonal relationships, and a dysfunctional emotional response. Like other chronic diseases, addiction often involves cycles of relapse and remission. Addiction is a process based in the altered functioning of the reward and motivation systems of the brain. Addiction can manifest in many ways, but it has historically been categorized into two main types. The first is substance-related addictions, which include the abuse of tobacco, alcohol, and street or prescription drugs. The second type of addiction involves behavioral or process addictions, which include problematic use of gambling, food, sex, the internet, and work. Contemporary science demonstrates that these two types of addictions can exist within the same individual, and that multiple variants of substance or process addictions can manifest within an individual at the same time. Thus, people can have multiple addictions, with each addiction being active to differing degrees of severity. Addiction has devastating consequences, not just for the user, but also for his or her family. Some of the personal costs include the loss of health, loss of relationships, loss of livelihoods, and of course, loss of life. The societal consequences are just as damaging, through loss of workplace productivity and higher costs for the healthcare, social welfare, and law enforcement systems. In 2002, the Canadian Centre on Substance Abuse estimated the overall social costs of substance abuse alone at $39.8 billion. So how do addictions develop? What are the key factors that lead to some of us being predisposed to addictions? Well, current research demonstrates that adverse childhood experiences appear to result in lowered stress tolerance and heightened stress reactivity in adulthood. One of these current researchers is Dr. Linda Mays. a professor of child psychiatry, pediatrics, and psychology at Yale University. Dr. Mays has done extensive work on the intergenerational transmission of parenting abilities, with a focus on stress exposure in early childhood. Here she talks about early stress and its effects on development.
There is an increasing evidence for the relationship between prenatal and early childhood adverse events or toxic stress exposures and the following chronic health conditions in adulthood: heart disease, cancer, increased rates of depression, drug abuse, and addictive disorders. The relationship between these and early childhood toxic stress. And we might ask, what are the potential mechanisms? And the broad mechanisms might include things such as exposure to early adversity during biologically sensitive periods, those sensitive periods that you've been learning about when you've been learning about brain development, the accumulating damage over time, that is, one adversity leads to another adversity. You get knocked down one time and you're more likely to be knocked down another, and gene by experience interactions, that you have certain risk genes and you're in a certain risk environment, which then bring come together and make these conditions more likely. And the central message, the key message that we're going to, that if you take nothing else away, would be this message right here, is that early chronic toxic stress compromises not only children's cognitive and emotional development, that's what you've been learning about, but that there's also, it compromises also specific capacities in those children when they become adults for their ability in turn to care for their children. So there's an enduring effect of toxic stress on learning and those capacities for learning, but also an enduring effect on toxic stress on the capacity to care for another individual, and hence intergenerational transmission.
If exposure to stress in early childhood can lead to adverse effects in adulthood, then what levels of stress are harmful to children? What kind of stress are we talking about? For this definition, we turn to Dr. Megan Gunner, who is a professor of child development at the University of Minnesota and an expert on stress neurobiology.
We like to talk about sort of three levels of stress that children experience. So positive stress are the brief increases in heart rate, the mild elevations of stress hormone that come along with trying to negotiate everyday life for children, right? They often experience these things when they challenge themselves. Tolerable stress are serious and temporary, serious activations of these biological systems to fairly significant stressors that can be pretty scary and upsetting. The key difference here is that the child has someone with them, access to supportive relationships to help them regulate what they're experiencing, helping them regulate their physiology and manage and cope with what they're experiencing. I have friends who study homeless and highly mobile children. They've looked at the various stressors in those kids' lives and the quality of the parenting relationship, the caregiving relationship, whether it's the parent, the grandparent, whoever is with the child in the shelter. The relationship is really, really critical to how that child is functioning. So you can add up a lot of different stressors, things that could cause toxic stress. The presence of supportive, caring adults in the child's lives can mitigate a lot. So tolerable stress, it's relationships. As Bill Clinton would say, it was relationships stupid. It works in the United States. He used to say it's money, you know, it's jobs and the economy stupid. Anyway, works in the U.S., not up here. The toxic stressors that we worry about are prolonged activation of these stress response or frequent activation in the absence, which typically can occur only in the absence of supportive relationships.
As Dr. Gunner mentioned, much of the stress we experience in our daily lives is both generated and regulated by our interactions with our parents. In fact, dysfunctional parenting has the consequence of creating similarly dysfunctional stress regulatory capacities in the infant and child. These problems may persist into adulthood and perpetuate the intergenerational transmission of parenting difficulties. In other words, children who do not learn to regulate stress effectively grow up and pass on this trait to their own children. Dr. Stephen Sumi is chief of the Laboratory of Comparative Ethology. Dr. Sumi and his research team examine the role of genetic and environmental factors in shaping individual psychological development in rhesus monkeys. His research demonstrates that the amount and quality of nurturing the monkeys experience is associated with responsiveness later in adulthood to stress, anxiety, and susceptibility to depression. Dr. Sumi calls this maternal buffering.
In every case, we see the same pattern. If there is a more efficient gene and a less efficient gene with respect to transcription, in every case, if the less efficient gene is paired with peer rearing, you get adverse outcomes. But that same less efficient gene paired with mother rearing, a competent mother, you get as good or better than normal performance. And this is, what does it tell us? This means good mothering is really damn important and can go a long way to protecting individuals who carry alleles that otherwise would put them at risk for developing various forms of behavioral and biological pathologies. Those same individuals, if they have a good mother, will turn out either normal or better than normal. And this is especially important to us because now increasingly it appears that good mothering or mothering styles in general are passed from one generation to the next. Usually, as we now know from elegant cross-fostering work by Dario Mastropietri, by non-genetic means. So here's a mechanism by which an individual, if you have individuals carrying risk alleles, but they had good mothers, they'll turn out normally, and if they become mothers themselves, they'll be good mothers to their own kids, and they'll turn out normally, and then when they become mothers to their own kids, and they carry these, so here's a way that the gene carrying a so-called risk allele can stay in a population generation after generation with no apparent adverse outcomes.
Positive and negative early experiences are important because genetic and environmental factors combine to influence the formation and function of the reward and motivational systems in early childhood. Scientific studies demonstrate that how we respond to novelty and challenge in the outside world is very sensitive to early experiences and to genetic risk. Hence, there are sensitive periods during early development and maturation when the architecture and chemistry of the reward systems in the brain can be changed and damaged. Dr. Mays explains.
All of us have rewards, the rewards that are highly salient. Whether it goes from exercising, coffee, shopping I have up here, our love lives, relationships are highly rewarding. These are the things that we seek. These are the things that are highly salient for us. And generally, if all is going well, we actually have some top-down regulation over our choice of rewards. We choose when we're feeling actually really stressed, for example, to take a walk in this beautiful setting. We choose to call a friend. We make choices on which we have planning, decision-making, of which rewards we will seek that help us regulate our stress. The point of that is that rewards, we use rewards to regulate when we're feeling upset or stressed, and we all have our individual ones. But under conditions of chronic stress, that sort of top-down regulation of reward disappears, and we turn to a kind of habitual, compulsive reward seeking. These same things that we might have under usual conditions, a kind of control over, become habitual. They become addictive. When all is going well, self-control is up there. But under chronic, toxic stress, actually, self-control goes down, and we begin to operate much more on the compulsive, habitual, lower subcortical regions of the brain. And what does that actually look like behaviorally? With early chronic toxic stress, we switch to this part, and it looks behaviorally like more impulsivity, poor decision-making, and lower distress tolerance.
Finally, it's important to note in this introduction that addiction is a chronic, relapsing brain disease and not simply a failure of will. People struggling with addiction use substances or engage in behaviors in ways that they can't control, even when it results in negative outcomes. Dr. Ray Baker is a physician and the medical director of HealthQuest Occupational Health Corporation, an organization in Vancouver specializing in addiction medicine. Dr. Baker has not only treated thousands of people with addiction, he also overcame his own addiction with drugs and alcohol. Here he details his personal struggle with addiction and how it altered his behavior so drastically that he nearly lost the life he worked so hard to establish.
I was a small town family doctor. It was mid-afternoon, so I was about 8 patients behind. The waiting room was full. I reached the point of being so overwhelmed that I let myself out the back door, and as far as I was concerned, it was over. I wasn't coming back. I had come to the conclusion, I don't know how many months before, that it couldn't get any worse. I felt so terrible that if it did get any worse, I was going to end my life. And of course, I didn't share that with anybody. So it was out of desperation, but I really didn't know what the problem was when I left.
So here's a summary of the key points in this podcast. Addiction is defined as a primary chronic disease of brain reward, motivation, memory, and related circuitry, and can be defined as two major categories: substance-related addictions and behavioral or process addictions. Addiction is a chronic, relapsing brain disease and not simply a failure of will. Early childhood adversity appears to result in lowered stress tolerance and heightened stress reactivity in adulthood, and this can set the ideal environmental conditions for the development of addiction. There are sensitive periods during early development and maturation when the architecture and chemistry of the reward systems in the brain can be changed and damaged. Positive and trusting relationships between an infant and caregiver, called secure attachment, confers resiliency to the young. So as we reach the end of this podcast, here are some reflective questions on the origins of addiction. They are based on the CanMed's competencies and address how you will deal with addiction in your practice. 1. Does this information about the role that early experiences and genetic risk can play in the architecture and chemistry of the reward systems in the brain influence your attitudes about individuals with addiction? 2. In your role as a medical student or practicing physician, how will you assist or advocate for patients with addiction in your practice? Do you think the rapport, relationship, and continuity of care you establish would be important? 3. In a family practice setting, do you think this new knowledge on positive and negative influences that can alter brain development in the early years could be integrated into family wellness programs? We hope that you've enjoyed this introductory podcast on the development of addiction. We welcome your comments in the feedback section at the bottom of this webpage, and we invite you to continue exploring this series as we examine in more detail the core concepts of early childhood development, as well as the types, causes, and treatment of addiction.